And all greetings, this is Gilles Mancillon. I wanted to come and say hello. I wanted also to celebrate the birth and ascension of the Buddha, which comes around this time. We do not know exactly what year that happened, but it is celebrated in the month of May as the Vesak portal, where the great light of the Buddha enters into the world and bless the world and comes to check on humanity. In essence, the Buddha, if you want to communicate with the Buddha, you come into meditation, you move into a still position, you relax your mind, you allow yourself to go into your heart, and then you visualize a doorway of light from within your heart chakra, and then you invite the Buddha. The Buddha comes in, and then you'll see, he will come, and then you communicate if you can, and then after the communication, whatever exchange that you may happen, you thank him, and you allow him to return into the inner planes, and you can deepen your connection to that frequency of Amitabha, the great archetype of that came into the world in order to show mankind a way to salvation, as many other masters have come before him and after him. I wanted also to share a little poem on his behalf. It's a poem of Amitabha Buddha. It's a poem that inspired two paintings of mine. One of them was lost, I hope I will find it, and the other one I lent to a friend who moved away with the painting. I hope I will see her again and get my paintings back one day. But in the meantime, it's a very beautiful poem. It's in French here, but I'm going to try to translate it. It says, "Abandon the spirit of self-interest. Look for a way to elevate yourself sublimely. Follow the example of the Buddha. Concentrate your thought, reassemble your spiritual energy with diligence so that you may expect, hope, to free yourself from the six ways of metempsychose and the four pains of karmic transmigration, birth, old age, illness, and death. Achieve sublimacy, return to the sphere of liberation." For the Buddha realized that we came into the that we live in a samsara, which there are six worlds that are where souls reintegrate eternally depending on their karma. From the bottom up, we have hell, we have the world of the hungry demons, of the fighting demons, the worlds of the brutes, the worlds of men, and the worlds of the gods. And so the soul will continually reincarnate until the soul has enough strength and lucidity, compassion and wisdom to elevate himself or herself above the sphere of the samsara, to move into that eternal sphere of nirvana, which means extension of breath. And so that is the process to eventually allow yourself to detach yourself from all the limitation of the world, so to speak. I also wanted to comment briefly on a painting that is below me, that is behind me. It's about but before I wanted to say that there is countless myth and legend about how the universe was created, where each religion, its mythology, has its own vision of it. We get to understand that all those things are facilitated in order to facilitate humankind in understanding that it is connected to something greater than what it believes. And so there may be conflict on the lower on time and space. There may be some conflicting, people may have conflicting thoughts and ideas because they believe that their reality is real, and then other people that their reality is real, and so they're trying to say, no, it's me. But on the higher planes, everything, all those great masters that inspired all those religions are in perfect harmony with the divine love of the source. There is absolutely no, they can be contradicting intelligence and aspects, but And yet, as soon as we move into the fourth and fifth dimension, it is never this or that, it is always this and that, so and everything else as well. So there is a great, we have to be understanding and tolerant, and so that we can integrate all those many aspects, as many as possible, so that we can enrich ourselves and draw on from those many sources, and follow whatever philosophical current that we feel close to, that our art is leading us towards. For I have my own history in relationship to all that. I hesitate to speak about that because it's a deep and powerful, profound memory, understanding about my story before before this whole thing happened, before this whole creation happened. For thousands of years, expressing those higher truths wasn't really appropriate because we live in a world that's hyper-materialist, and so when you expose deep inner truth, esoteric truth, to someone who's not ready, it may be more harmful than useful, and that's why the great wise man named Lao Tzu said, he who knows does not speak, he who speaks does not know, because he knew that humanity was not ready to receive that higher truth. And so when a master had achieved ascension or enlightenment, he would only share the secret and teachings to those people that he saw that very light karma and were ready to move on to something else. Yet we are moving into a time where the whole planet is ascending, so we have to make an effort to share our belief, to share our thoughts, to share our vision, to share our ideas, so that we may inspire and assist each other in the process of evolution. And so, as far as for me, and it's not the one of the highest revelation in terms of the history of the universe and spirituality is this book named the Urantia book. This one is in French, but I also have it in English. It's the original is in English. I've read it about six times already. It's completely available in audiobook if you're looking for it. You can listen to it while you're doing something else or while you travel. You can, but it's also completely readable at www.urantia.org. And so this book can be, you can already look in it. There is all kinds of wonderful things, all kinds of amazing understanding that kind of bridge all kinds of things about all those many teachings of all those many different current of spirituality. And so I thought I would speak of that again. I also wanted to share a little bit about this painting. It's my magic stick. Get my little magic stick here. So this painting is in essence, it is a symbolic representation of the cosmology of Urantia, what is revealed in the Urantia book. Urantia is the name of our planet from a celestial point of view. Our local universe is Nebadon. It is a little point within the great super universe of Orvonton. In essence, this is the paradise families. They're all organized, and so this is very complex, and you can always talk about it, but maybe a bit later. And in essence, what I wanted to say is that for a very long time, this represents the central isle of paradise, with the 21 sacred spheres of paradise, the sacred world, and the central universe. For eternity, this was all that was paradise and the central universe. And then one day the gods informed everybody that something was happening beyond the central universe, they called it the samsara. And so that is now what we are doing. We are involved in the process of evolution in time and space. And eventually the whole of time and space will become settled in light and life. And at which point, when all of the realities, the 700,000 local universe of time and space with the 7 trillion planets, will have and countless individuals will all have attained that state of fusion with the light, the supreme light, then the supreme being will come out and take over the rulership of all of time and space. But then beyond that, there is the transcendental universe of the future. There are 4 levels, and it, it, the There is two great mysteries on paradise. The first is the history of God. Nobody knows. The gods do not communicate beyond the very little, for life is self-revealing. And also about the transcendental, the reality of the future, the future of the master universe that is also completely, will be revealed in due time. For as long as there is an evolution in time and space, the first level of transcendental universe will not be inaugurated. So for now, we are perfect in time and space. The story went that in the dawn of we get that from the infinite spirit, because that's he was the only one that did communicate on that, but he didn't say that much. He said that hypothetically, for the paradise trinity, paradise and the central universe has always existed. There's never been a time where the Father was not with the Son and the Spirit. Yet for mortal man and linear time thinking, there is a concept that was expressed that at some hypothetical point, the universal Father must have existed alone, but yet he manifested an absolute person, the eternal Son, which is the absolute manifestation of the spiritual person that is the Father, and the central Isle of Light, which is the absolute manifestation of physicality, and all of that is non-personal within the Father. And the tension between the personal and the material, the absolute spiritual and the absolute material, eventuated the presence of the infinite spirit, which is the infinite mind of God that took on the patterns of paradise and manifested this central creation, the 1 billion perfect sphere of ultimate perfection, and activated later the mechanism of time and space. For the infinite spirit is the conjoint actor, it is the God of action, it is the one that that understands the mind of the Father and the Son and put it into action in manifestation, and that created the cosmos. So this is quite, of course, it may be a little short in order to understand, but there is a lot of stories there is a lot to be discovered about all that. For eventually we will have to access, eventually we will access to those memories, those understanding, those realities, and they will be self-revealed within our mind when we are ready for it. And so I also wanted to share another book that may be interesting for those who are interested in such thing. I didn't talk about it because it's a book I read about 15 years ago. But it's a book that was out of print and very rare, so I didn't talk about it because it was impossible to get. But I saw that it was republished and translated in many languages. It's called The Keys of Enoch, which is now available. It's been reprinted and it's been translated. The Keys of Enoch. It's been made by Metatron and Enoch. It's an illustrated book, and it's quite technical. It's 64 keys, and the understanding. There's great illustration, and there is a lot of very encoded information. But it's very, very powerful. It is designed to create the Merkaba, the chariot, the vehicle for transcendental ascension, and moving from the universe of the Son to the universe of the Father. So all of that is connected, all of this is one. It is just different approach to the same thing, and as we move forward, we reconnect to those understandings. So the card of the day, I wanted to make a little oracle. The card of the day is paradigm shift. We are moving, we are changing the whole paradigm. We are moving into a new level. We are moving from fear into love, from separation into unity. And so this is really what's happening. We move slowly but surely into that that greater integration, that greater stillness, that greater fulfillment. And as we allow, we drop all our thoughts, ideas, and beliefs, this divine light can reveal itself, manifest itself, and as we cultivate it, we are able to allow it to unfold within ourselves, and we follow that, and we see where with that we will definitely get guided and led by this great light. For this voice of the heart has always been our guide. That's the only guide that we need, in essence, and that is always here. it's never left us. It is just our mind has been so busy, we kind of pushed it down, but now it is becoming more manifested, let's say. So do pay attention to your inner voice, for that is your guide, that is your source talking to you. I'm going to finish with a little song that has no spiritual context whatsoever, but it's a beautiful song. I really like it, except the title. It's called Hallelujah. It goes like this. I heard there was a sacred chord that David played and it pleased the Lord. But you don't really care for music, do you? It goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall and the major lift, the baffled king composing Hallelujah, 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 Hallelujah. Face was strong, but you needed proof. You saw her bathing on the roof, her beauty in the moonlight overthrew you. She tied you to a kitchen chair, she cut your throne and she broke your throne and she cut your hair, and from your lips she drew the Hallelujah, Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Hallelujah, Hallelujah. Baby, I've been here before, I've seen this room and I walk this floor. I used to live alone before I knew you. And I've seen your flag on the marble arch, and love is not some victory march. It's a cold and it's a broken Hallelujah. 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 There was a time when you let me know what's really going on below, but now you never show it to me, do you? I remember when I moved in you, and the holy dove was moving too, and every breath we drew was Hallelujah, Hallelujah, Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Hallelujah. Well, maybe there's a God above, but all I've ever learned from love was how to shoot somebody who outdrew you. And it's not a cry that you hear at night, it's not somebody who's seen the light, it's a cold and it's a broken Hallelujah, 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 Hallelujah. Well, thank you very much for staying till the end. I wish you a wonderful day and I'll talk to you later. Namaste.